Before we proceed, the flowers that are placed on the dais in memory of the precious students that recently lost their lives in the Robb Elementary School shooting in Uvalde, Texas, and in memory of North Stanley High School student Joe Haycock that recently passed away. Our thoughts and our prayers are with the families of these students during these most difficult times. May God, our most gracious and heavenly Father, provide comfort to all of these families. Will you please join me in a moment of silence? Thank you. At this time, I would like to call on Mr. Bill Sorensen for our invocation and our pledge of allegiance to the flag.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you with humble hearts and gratitude. We are grateful for the countless blessings we all enjoy and thankful for this opportunity to come together on behalf of Stanley County's children. We pray for forgiveness of our sins in thought, deed, action, and inaction, and ask you to direct our hearts and minds as we deliberate our agenda and celebrate our victories. Lead us to make decisions that best serve the children and reveal your will in their lives. We ask you to bless and protect every child in Stanley County so they may return to our schools in August. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Sorensen. Board members, as Dr. Dennis is introducing this highly anticipated group, I'm going to suggest that we move out of our chairs into the audience because, trust me, you do not want to miss this. So, Dr. Dennis, I'm going to turn it over to you and board members. I'm going to ask that we just kind of walk out there and we can stand along the wall or somewhere, but I'm not going to miss this.
Members of the board and everyone in the audience, I had the opportunity to attend the Mamma Mia concert a couple weeks ago. And, you know, I grew up watching the West Stanley Players, and I've always been enamored and in awe of the productions that they put forth and the talent that they have. And I have to say, it was an exceptional show. I talked to Mr. Tucker beforehand. I said, well, you know, I've got a five-year-old I'm bringing here late at night. He said, oh, I promise we'll keep him entertained. And I'm telling the truth, aren't I, Mr. Tucker? My five-year-old went home, was dancing in bed, singing Dancing Queen as soon as we got home. It was highly entertaining, but I also just can't, as far as Mr. Tucker, your ability to put together productions, amazing. And I cannot take away from the students that you guys are an incredible talent. I wish I had some of the talents you did. Your ability to entertain, your ability to sing and dance, a production like this, oh, we got one coming in late. Production like this is just outstanding. So I'll let Mr. Tucker take it from here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. West Stanley Players have had a banner year. We produced three different shows this year. One of our first ones was a fall murder mystery dinner theater. We played to four sold out audiences in Oakbury at the Music Hall, and then moved over here to the boardroom and did two more performances. And then we moved on to several more small shows with our drama club at the West Stanley Middle School. And then we produced our major spring production this year, Mamma Mia. Mamma Mia was one of our largest productions and our most successful productions. We did five productions with capacity crowds and probably one of our most successful shows in our 51-year history. However, all of that goes to our students. They work tireless. They give up their spring breaks and work about 16 hours a day while their friends are at the beach and their friends are relaxing, and they're there every morning They're learning to dance. Many of them had never danced before. They're learning to sing. They're learning choreography. They're learning all kinds of performances. Then they spend the afternoon rehearsing, and then they spend the night working on the set. Our set, its highest point this year, was 24 feet tall and mimicked a Greek taverna. They spent Saturday afternoons, and over the course of about 3 months, they were able to produce a show. So, for those of you parents that I know you're so proud of all your kids, we have outstanding kids in the Stanley County school system. No matter what high school you go to, they are a pleasure. We've got outstanding athletes and outstanding theater kids, band kids, all of that. And so it is a very, very proud moment to be a Colt. For all of our Colts, we've had a great year and to be a part of the school system. So I'm not going to talk anymore because we've got two numbers that we're going to do for you. One is one of our slower songs, and then we're going to get you dance a little bit with the Dancing Queen. So I'm going to turn it over to Donna and Sophie, and they're going to perform one of our favorite songs from the show, Slipping Through My Fingers.
Goodbye with an absent-minded smile.
them to switch up a microphone. This is Brooke Toberlin. She's a junior at West Allen, and she played Donna in the production. And this is Sophie Tucker, and she played Sophie Sheridan in the production. That particular number she saw on the show was particularly hard for a dad because she wore a wedding dress and sang about how she was slipping through their fingers and moving on. And she's graduating and moving out, and she's my baby, so she's the last one. So it's kind of difficult for me. So our next number we're going to do, make sure Cindy gets her mic on and ready to go. You good? Is one of, great thing about Mamma Mia, it was a feel-good musical. We needed a feel-good musical this time. We needed people to be happy. We've had a rough couple years for our high school students. And so this, at the end of every night, got people up and dancing in the aisle. So Brooke is going to be joined with Cindy and Mercy as the Dynamos. And they are going to do a little dancing queen. So feel free to get up and dance with them if you want to.
Please help us sing. Okay. Please help us sing.
That was amazing. More than amazing. Mr. Wes Tucker, thank you. And Ms. Ann McClendon, I know that you...
I didn't do anything
but I tell you.
She's an outstanding principal. Very supportive.
I know.
Dancing with us all the time.
I know. I love it. And, you know, I think I told you, Wes, I think this one rates up there. I think I told you maybe in my top three, but the more I think about it, this one's my tops. Absolutely. Thank you. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you.
Well, Dr. Dennis, next on our agenda is recognition of, wow. I mean, wow, look at these students and athletes and band. Dr. Dennis, I'm going to turn this over to you. It is a night filled with awesome recognitions.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to bring Ms. Beverly Pennington, our county athletic director, up here to present some I guess you got them. Okay, good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Madam Chair, board members, we are in the presence of some champions tonight. Look at this crowd. So, I know we're on a time frame, but I've just got to tell you all about these wonderful groups. First of all, and I'm just going to recognize you in the order that you were claimed champion, okay? So first up, we have our South Stanley High School men's golf team. Gentlemen, if you'll come up here, and Coach Smith, I see you over there, if you'll come and stand in front of the board for me, please. These are our 1A state champions in golf, coached by none other than Doug Smith. He tells me that y'all started out a little rough. I think you lost your first conference match, but it was uphill from thereafter. He says it put a lot of pressure on you not to lose another match because, board, they're in a split conference, and had they lost another match, we would not be here tonight. But they continued to win. They finished the season with just one loss, that first one, but they tied with Union Academy. So another kind of gut-wrenching moment when we had to determine who was that conference champ. And because they had beat Union Academy in the regular season, they were deemed conference champs. And I think y'all just hit your peak at the right time. Y'all just kept improving and going strong. So they were crowned conference champions and won a regional qualifying team. Notable accomplishments also include Stanley County Championship, the conference championship, the Midwest Regional Champions, and then on to the 1A State Championship. Jacob Turner, is he with us here tonight? Jacob, right here. Congratulations. He was awarded the 1A State High School Athletic Association Sportsmanship Award. The best part, all six players return next year. So watch out, everybody in their conference. Congratulations. And if y'all were, we're going to get some pictures, okay? Okay, you guys can be seated. Again, congratulations. Our next state champions from this spring season came from track and field. If I could please have Natalie Almond and Ollie Curry come on down, and their coaches. Okay, Miss Natalie Allman is the 2A state champion in the girls 1600 meter run. Coaches are Wes Herlocker and Brandon Morton. Natalie earned all county, all conference, all region, and all state. Quite the list. She was also chosen as the conference runner of the year. Natalie holds the school record in the 800, the 1600, and the 3200. Natalie will be attending Catawba College in the fall, where she will continue to run competitively. Congratulations, Natalie. You'll just stay right there. Ali, you've been here before. You were named the 1A state champion in boys triple jump. His coach is Coach Bernard Henry. And this is Ali's second time standing before you. He was named state champion in the same event last year. He has earned Conference Male Athlete of the Year, Conference Track Male Athlete of the Year, All-Conference Team, and Stanley County Field Athlete of the Year. Ali will be attending North Carolina A&T in the fall, where he hopes to walk on to the track and field team. Congratulations, Ali. Y'all just stay right there. We're gonna get some pictures. Together?
I'll do together.
Together, and then we'll do West and then Albemarle. Thank you. Congratulations. Now, board, you'll see that we still have quite a few to go because we have two softball teams to recognize tonight. And think about it. In the state championship, it comes down to eight softball teams in the whole state. We have of the four champions, the 1A, 2A, 3A, 4A, we have two of the four state champions in Stanley County. Okay, so South Stanley, if you'll come up and join me up front. South Stanley High School women's softball is coached by head coach David Poplin and assistants Matthew Little, Emily Poplin Morton, and Sarah Beth Thomas. This team had zero losses in 1A competition. Nobody beat them. This was their second straight trip to the 1A state championship, where this year they took care of business by defeating the Beargrass Charter team in the first of a two-game series. So they just got right to work. Let's just win two and go home. That's the way we like it. I'd like to congratulate the team and also senior Allie Glover for being named MVP of the state tournament. Allie will be continuing to play softball at Bluefield University. Congratulations,
yeah,
ladies.
Allie. Thank you, ladies. Congratulations.
Ms. Pennington, before these girls sit down, well, number one, Ms. Poplin and I got really sunburn out there watching you. I want you to know. Okay, who's the pitcher? Oh, my goodness. That was amazing. And then who is that girl that played left field that did all that catching? A freshman. Oh, wow. And then, who's the girl that, when we were sitting there biting our nails when it was two outs that first game, who's 15? Man, you are a monster. That's awesome. Girls, that's amazing. Congratulations to y'all.
Thank you.
Madam Madam Chair, Coach Poplin would like to say a few words.
I'm sorry, I was stealing the thunder, wasn't I?
No, you're fine, you're great. Madam Chair, Board, thank you for having us tonight. For those of you that don't know us or anything about us, probably because you hadn't seen us play, we are South Stanley. We are a team, but these are individuals that make our team so special. Emma Campbell, senior leadership, timely hitting throughout the season. Allie Glover, stay out there. 23 wins, over 200 strikeouts. There's a story behind Allie that I would love to share with people. She is a true heart of an athlete. Maddie Poulos, 16 home runs, 50 hits, 60 RBIs. Tremendous season. Jacqueline Allman, steady play throughout the season. Sacrifice bunt to advance a runner to help score a run in the state championship game. Skylar Malden, solid catching throughout the year and a wonderful job handling our pitching staff. Cassie Swink, solid leadoff hitter all year, tremendous base runner. Cassidy Smith, Cinderella story of two outs, two strikes, bases loaded in the bottom of the seventh, triple to win game one in the championship series. And I've talked to several folks that was either there or listening or watching and said they could not come back Saturday for fear of having a heart attack. And I won't mention any names, but he's just sitting up there. Mary Ryan Henson's Sportsmanship Award winner, solid play throughout the playoffs. Alexis Hallward, two big hits in a championship game, outstanding base running, fine defensive play. Elena Hallward's rediscovery of her love of softball and the fun kid on the team. Riley Dennis, undeniable work ethic and ambition to be the best player that she can be. Assistant coach Matt Little, we would be lost without Matt. His head coaching ability without the head coach title. Assistant coach Emily Poplin Morton, her second state championship, 10 years ago as a player, this year as a coach. Assistant coach Sarah Beth Thomas, initiative to do anything asked to make this team better, and we ask a lot of Sarah Beth. These individuals created a team that put together the best softball season in our school history and one of the finest years in the state this year in all classifications. And with only 12, we had no JV team, this is it. This team put together a 30-win season with only 3 losses by a combined 4 runs. This team played 20 games at home this season, which is unheard of at this day and time. A lot of teams, if you get 20 period, we played 20 at home at South Stanley, winning 19 of those. And for the folks that couldn't make the short drive to South to see these young ladies play, you missed out seeing a fine group of athletes play a game with passion, competitive spirit, true sportsmanship, and a never quit attitude. No one likes to feel unseen or unappreciated, but many times our student athletes do, especially our female athletes. They work equally hard as their male counterparts and are very aware, more than you may want to believe, of teachers and classmates that come to watch them play. As are coaches, equally aware of principals and administrators that show interest to attend games or send congratulation emails and text. We have a great principal. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Thank you. You see, it's more than just a sport or a game to some of us. It's not about the wins, the losses, the winning awards, getting a paycheck. It's about the passion that we have and we share as players and coaches that matters. So thank you to those that showed up this year and supported South Stanley softball. Here and here, ladies in green, you are looking at some of the finest talent in the state of North Carolina, and they're only 14 miles apart, or 14 miles from each other, with Oakboro being pretty much in the middle. These two teams did an awesome job representing Stanley County in a positive light and with true sportsmanship, and not just this past weekend, but all season, even our battle at the beach. What a weekend. That was a blast. West Stanley Lady Colts and Coach Emily, congratulations once again on a great season and your state championship. I applaud you. And especially to Mr. Bill Sorensen, Mr. Rufus Leffler, Miss Glenda Gibson, Miss Carla Poplin, and Mr. Tim Hatley. Thank you for sitting in our stands, cheering us on, or sending me, the old guy, personal congratulations on our win this past weekend. Your individual support combines to make a collective team, a collective difference. Thank you. Over the season, Mr. Jeff Springer. Jeff, are you here? Okay. Jeff Springer is our pitching coach. Basically, he's taught a lot of girls along the county, several counties. He shared some tried and true knowledge that we've all heard from one point or another, and that is to never quit. South Stanley softball never quit this season. They didn't quit on each other. They didn't quit on the game. They didn't quit on me. And neither did our state tennis champion, J.C. Noble, or our state wrestling champion, Ranferry Garcia, or our state men's golf team, and our students at South, who are state champions in my book. We have some wonderful teachers, wonderful students, and we all make a great team. You should come see us sometime. South Stanley is a great place. Thank you.
West Stanley High School softball, if you'll come take the stage for me. By head coach Emily Smith and assistants Walker Barbie and Aaron Hartzell, the Colts finished the 22 season with a 29-1 record. This ties the school record for the most wins in a single season. On the way to the state 2A championship, they won the Rocky River Conference regular season with an 8-0 league record. They started the season 5-3 before winning 24 of the final 25 games. Wow, what an accomplishment. In the state championship series, you faced Washington High School, who came in undefeated. Well, sorry, guys, you handed them a defeat in that first game and the second game. And they were outscoring their opponents 286-32. The Lady Colts won game one with a 4-1 victory and clinched the title in game two by a score of 3-2. MVP for the state tournament was Lily Honeycutt. Lily, where are you? Congratulations. Understand that you struck out 21 batters during the two-game series. That's wonderful. And then Kaylin Little will continue to play softball at Winthrop University. So congratulations to everyone. Coach Smith, do you want to say anything? Yes.
I don't have anything prepared, so this is just going to be from the heart. But I want to first off thank the board and thank Dr. Dennis and Beverly for asking us to be here. It is such an honor to be before you. I first want to give a shout out to Ms. McClendon, our principal, for just being amazing and always being there to support us. You know, as I look at these girls, it's hard not to get emotional. Just thinking back to February when we started, and where we started from. And like Ms. Pennington said, we started out 5-3. And those were some tough days. I think that everybody here would agree. You know, in the past couple seasons, we had not lost many games. And so starting with that, we had to dig deep within ourselves to figure out where we wanted to go. And then we won 24 of the next 25 games, leading us to a third consecutive state championship. You know, I think that is a major shout out to the two seniors we have. They both have three state championships under their belt. If COVID had not canceled 2020, you never know. So I'm just, I can't put into words how proud I am of this team in their fight. You know, my two assistant coaches are just amazing beyond words. I can't thank them enough for their hard work. And a lot of times over the weekend, I just thought back to it, and it just leaves me speechless. I'm so thankful for the opportunity to coach you girls every single day. And I just couldn't be more proud of the athletes you are, but more importantly, the people that you are. And also a shout out to Coach Poplin at South, who coached when I was in high school. And I always enjoyed playing against South. Sometimes we lost, so I didn't enjoy that. But, you know, I can't say enough about their program as well. And just both teams winning the state championship is just amazing. So thank you again for having us, and we appreciate it so much.
Who's the pitcher? All right, so just a little story. I come to your game because my wife's from Durham, and we had a family event. So obviously you're in Chapel Hill, which was a 20-minute drive for me. And trying to get to your game was one of the most arduous things ever. I blew a tire. I had to go back and get a truck and do this, that, and the other. So I did not get there to the bottom of the sixth inning. And so you guys were just taking and going into the seventh. And then, of course, that triple happened that made stuff very interesting. That was clutch, what you did down that. And all of you girls, I mean, I hate I missed it. I tried to get there as hard as I could. And I know y'all had a great game, but that was outstanding. And congratulations to all of you. I want to say one thing, though, before you leave, that the Stanley News and Press today, County of Champions, we have South Stanley and West Stanley. Together, Stanley County won half of the softball championships for the entire state. Congratulations. Thank you. Got one more recognition before we end this portion tonight. Is Nye Burris here? Nye. Oh, come on up. Come on. Sorry. You can come here with me. So Nye Burris made and played an all-state band. I guess first you had to make district, and then you had made. And this is a huge accomplishment. I mean, there is only a select number of students throughout the entire state who made all-state band. I don't know the last time we've had one, prior to COVID, but I know in districts past that I've worked in, it's very rare, and obviously you're an extremely talented musician. Would you like to talk a little bit about your experience?
I guess I can.
Yeah.
It was incredible. I've never really had as much of an opportunity to perform with a group that big. So it was just incredible, especially because they're so talented and they're very lovely people getting to perform with. So it was really fun.
Well, thank you, Nye. I know West Stanley's proud, I know the county's proud, I know your family's proud, and congratulations. It's a big accomplishment.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's all I have, Madam Chair.
The board certainly wants to thank and congratulate all of our athletes, certainly the band member there,
our coaches, our band directors, our drama director, our drama students, everyone, the softball championships, champion teams from Stanley County, you make us so proud. And I want you to know that from the bottom of our hearts, you make us so proud. I know that we are on a real time crunch here on our agenda because we have more recognitions coming up, but our board is going to enter into a closed session for a few minutes. Again, congratulations to all of you. Thank you so, so much. Thank you. At this time, board members, I would like to entertain a motion for the board to enter into closed session for personnel matters, North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11(a)(6), student matters, North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11(a)(1), attorney-client matters, North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11(a)(3), and acquisition of real property, North Carolina General Statute 143-318.005. May I have a motion to enter into closed session?
I make a motion and go into closed session.
A motion by Ms. Poplin, a second.
A second.
A second by Mr. List. All in favor say aye. Opposed, no. The board is now in closed session. Good evening. I would like to call the board back into open session. I think maybe we have different people in here this time, Dr. Dennis. Some cleared out, I believe, from before. We just have a night of wonderful recognitions, and all of these recognitions make us so very proud. So Dr. Dennis, I'm turning this over to you.
Yeah, the comment was made that it was like a magic show. We went in that room and come back and all the people were replaced with different people. This is one of my favorite times, being able to recognize staff that are so dedicated to our students and their education and their schools and their communities. So I'm going to bring Mr. Lynn Plummer up here to help me with these, and Dr. Blake Lewis as well.
Good evening, Chairman Gibson and members of the board. I'm excited to close out the 2021-2022 school year with some very special recognitions of our own staff. The 2021-2022 school year has been filled with challenges, but our schools have taken every opportunity to provide a quality education for every student throughout the district. Our teachers have worn many different hats to help our schools move forward, building relationships with students and their families. But through the changes we have experienced, one thing has remained consistent. Both staff members and families of Stanley County School students have worked together to ensure our students are taken care of. We have remained steadfast in the support we have given, promising to do what is best for our children. To our school leaders, our teachers, our teacher assistants, our counselors, our office support, our custodians, our cafeteria workers, our bus drivers, I thank every single staff member of Stanley County Schools for all you do to continue, that you continue to do for our schools and students. Today is a celebration. What better way to end the 2021-22 school year than by recognizing some of our very own dedicated Stanley County Schools employees. While we have a vast staff that is dedicated to the success of our students and communities, we come together today to recognize five outstanding individuals on the district level and many people from all of our schools. Please join me as we celebrate our own. At this time, I would like to recognize the five finalists for Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Beginning Teacher of the Year. Miss Reagan Allen, North Stanley High School. Miss Amber Britt, East Albemarle Elementary School. Miss Caroline Brown, Albemarle High School. Miss Shanna Crump, Central Elementary School. Miss Madison Ragsdale, Central Elementary School. Our 2021-2022 Beginning Teacher of the Year says her goal as a teacher is for students to always know her classroom is a safe place for them. She wants her students to discover themselves and be able to think critically, promoting individual growth to give her students a body of knowledge. Teaching is important to her because she wants her students to learn and grow. She helps them find their passion and learn to love new things. She enjoys inspiring students and making an impact on future generations. Our Beginning Teacher of the Year has been impacted by her support of family and community engagement throughout the school. She has seen firsthand the positive effects and outcomes that occur when the school and community work together toward a common goal. She has found a great deal of support with her students' parents and their partnership in their students' education. Above all, our Beginning Teacher of the Year supports the importance of making connections and building relationships with our students to provide positive and encouraging learning environments. Developing effective relationships with students is an integral part of helping the students succeed. At this time, I am honored to announce Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Beginning Teacher of the Year, Ms. Madison Ragsdale. Congratulations, Ms. Ragsdale. Please welcome Stanley County Schools Director of Career Technical Education, Ms. Mandy Melton, for the CTE Teacher of the Year Award presentation.
Good evening, board members. It is my pleasure to present the first ever CTE Teacher of the Year Award. This teacher provides her students with a wealth of real-world skills and experiences to complement her agriculture classroom at West Stanley High School. She goes above and beyond, not only for her students, but also her peers. She is most likely found at the barn with a pig named Daisy, a cow named Sky, and in my opinion, a very scary bearded dragon named Ricky, and a host of other animals. It is my honor to congratulate the 2021-2022 CTE Teacher of the Year, Natalie Rogers.
Congratulations, Ms. Rogers. At this time, I would like to recognize the award recipients for the 2021-2022 Classified Support Staff of the Year at each of our schools. Aquedale Elementary, Kenneth Spencer. Baden Elementary, Selma White. Central Elementary, Paula Little. East Albemarle Elementary, Karen Honeycutt. Indy Elementary, Wilmer Castillo, Mr. C. Locust Elementary, Susan Yao. Millingport Elementary, Dana Allen. Norwood Elementary, Tanya Edwards. Oakboro Elementary, Sandy Duarte. Richfield Elementary, Lynette Whitley. Stanfield Elementary, Jamie Hamilton. Albemarle Middle, Milton Horn. North Stanley Middle, Angie Bumgarner. South Stanley Middle, Tammy Buck. West Stanley Middle, Pam White. Albemarle High, Edith Smith. North Stanley High, Stephen Butler. South Stanley High, Heather Long. Stanley Academy, Tony Steele. West Stanley High, Edna Edge. At this time, I would like to recognize the award recipients for the 2021-2022 Certified Support Staff of the Year at each of our schools. Aquadale Elementary, Susan Bird. Baden Elementary, Lee McClamrock. Central Elementary, Sherry Burris. East Albemarle Elementary, Kim Dean. Indy Elementary, Rebecca Little. Locust Elementary, Brittany Sidelak. Millingport Elementary, Anthony Wilson. Norwood Elementary, Janice Lee. Oakboro Choice STEM, Jennifer Snyder Crawford. Richfield Elementary, Rebecca Stepp. Stanfield Elementary, April Klutz. Albemarle Middle, Janae Kimball. North Stanley Middle, Katie Green. South Stanley Middle, Leslie Hanna. West Stanley Middle, Mary Barbie. Albemarle High, Lisa Talbert. North Stanley High, Shelley Whitley. South Stanley High, Meredith Sawyer. Stanley Academy, Tracy Swearingen. And West Stanley High, Nikki Cleaver. Congratulations. I would like to take this time to recognize and congratulate our 2021-2022 Teachers of the Year from each of our schools in the district. Aquadale Elementary, Dana Bowers Yang. Baden Elementary, Jennifer Ingram. Central Elementary, Christy Talbert. East Albemarle Elementary, Emily Harrison. Indy Elementary, Cindy Beeling. Locust Elementary, Amy Louder. Millingport Elementary, Diane Austin. Norwood Elementary, Rebecca Burleson. Oakboro Choice STEM, Jennifer Crawford. Richfield Elementary, Crystal Morris. Woo-hoo! Stanfield Elementary, Heather Nance. Scove, Judy Almond. Albemarle Middle, Sean Grafe. North Stanley Middle, Stephen Wilcox. South Stanley Middle, Beth Gentry. West Stanley Middle, Paige Parker. Albemarle High, Chandra Snuggs. North Stanley High, Joanna Gagliardi. South Stanley High, AJ Bennett. Stanley Academy, Teresa Crump. Stanley Early College, Victor Ubaldo. Stanley STEM Early College, Darcy Tomasino. And West Stanley High School, Thomas LaBianca. We are grateful that each of these outstanding teachers chooses to call Stanley County Schools home. Congratulations to each of these honorees as they have been recognized by their colleagues from their own schools. At this time, I would like to recognize the three finalists for Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Teacher of the Year. If you would please step forward. Ms. Jennifer Ingram, Baden Elementary School. Mr. Stephen Wilcox, North Stanley Middle School. And Mr. Thomas LaBianca, West Stanley High School. Our 2021-2022 Teacher of the Year describes Stanley County Schools as a welcoming melting pot, a phenomenal place where everyone works their hardest each and every day. They believe in leading by example, playing the part, and rubbing off on others. Success is derived from student performance, effective discipline, rapport with students, and relationships within the school community. Our Teacher of the Year ensures that education transcends the classroom by encouraging students to explore the world around them, continuously learning from their experiences. They believe that students need an orderly and safe learning environment with clear and concise expectations. We should attempt to be proactive, not reactive, by establishing schools and classrooms that run like well-oiled machines. Our Teacher of the Year encourages teachers not to be discouraged. Teaching is not a one-size-fits-all approach. We must stick with it and persevere. They believe that each and every individual, with their own specific interests, talents, knowledge, and areas of expertise, can work together to accomplish what our nation as a whole sets our minds to. At this time, I am honored to announce Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Teacher of the Year, Mr. Stephen Wilcox. At this time, I would like to recognize the three finalists for Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Assistant Principal of the Year. Ms. Brooke Davis, West Stanley Middle School. Ms. Kelly Hill, Central Elementary School. Mr. Marty Ingram, West Stanley High School. Our 2021-2022 Assistant Principal of the Year truly believes in a team leadership approach. They believe in doing everything they can to take tasks off teachers' plates, giving them the opportunity to focus on instruction and data analysis. They believe in being personable and accessible, a great listener, and reflective in their daily practices. Transparency is important in carrying out the responsibilities of the assistant principal. Our assistant principal of the year loves their students and claims seeing them is the highlight of each day. They strive to do their best every day, knowing teachers and students deserve the best from them. They are eager to be in classrooms every day and carry out their duties as a servant leader. Their motivation comes from students, parents, and the community, because after all decisions should be based on what's best for children. Our assistant principal of the year brings lots of energy to the table, a willingness to put themselves out there to do new things. They are described by their peers as being extremely dedicated and committed to the profession, having a strong understanding of curriculum and best practices of teaching, and bringing a dedication to get the job done the right way while enlightening everyone with a bright, bubbly personality and lots of laughs, a positive energy, and a problem-solving mindset. They epitomize what giving back to your community looks like in action. If Albemarle Schools were their own district, they would be the mascot. Please welcome Stanley County Schools 2020-2021 Assistant Principal of the Year, Ms. Judith Taylor, for the award presentation.
Good evening, everyone. I am honored to announce Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Assistant Principal of the Year, Ms. Kelly Hill. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Ms. Hill. And last, but not least, I would like to recognize the three finalists for Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Principal of the Year. Mr. Kevin Adams, Stanley Early College, and Stanley STEM Early College. Ms. Megan DePascal, Millingport Elementary School. Ms. Ann McClendon, West Stanley High School. Our 2021-2022 Principal of the Year is an instructional leader who believes in practicing what they preach to ensure that effective learning is happening throughout the school. Being positive and setting a positive atmosphere to solve problems, be proactive, and look down the road keeps our Principal of the Year excited about school. They believe that the whole school community must be invested in the success of our students, starting with the principal pitching in to show that they are a key part of setting a positive culture. To our Principal of the Year, perception is reality for our school communities. They are a forward-thinking leader who relies on prescriptive approaches in order to move a school forward. Culture, safety and order, and instruction are all important factors in supporting and engaging students. They believe good things happen when you work hard and do the things you are supposed to do. Our Principal of the Year is described by their peers as keeping a positive outlook and high morale, never asking staff to do anything they aren't willing to do, wearing many hats throughout the school, and doing so with grace. In the end, they live out an important principle instilled in them by their father. Everybody counts, everybody's important. Please welcome Stanley County Schools 2020-2021 Principal of the Year, Dr. Eric Johnson, for the award presentation.
I am honored to announce Stanley County Schools 2021-2022 Principal of the Year, Mr. Kevin Adams.
Madam Chair, can I just proceed? Perfect. We do, okay, want to?
The board would like to congratulate and say great appreciation and how much we value all of you that were just recipients, all of you who came up here and were recognized. You make up Stanley County Schools, and that's why Stanley County Schools is the best. We appreciate you so much. Congratulations. This time we still have more recognitions. This is the best day.
I know, I love this part.
More recognitions. Dr. Amy Blake Lewis, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We have some recognition of schools. Upon inquiry from board member Mr. Bill Sorensen, who inquired about creating an award to recognize our schools for high growth, and in conjunction with Ms. Melissa Smith, our Director of Community Engagement Dropout Prevention, we were able to secure a sponsor for a new award. We would like to recognize Mr. Dusty Laney, who is the owner and operator of Skate City, as being the sponsor of this new award. We looked at overall composite growth among our schools in four categories: elementary, middle, high, and specialty schools. And we will begin a new tradition here tonight of passing these wonderful trophies along each year to those schools who show the highest growth each year as measured by their composite growth on EOG or EOC test. So the first school I would like to recognize is our elementary school of high growth, Indy Elementary, Principal Ms. Jody Autry. Our middle school of high growth, West Stanley Middle School, Principal Jennifer Honeycutt. Our high school, School of High Growth, South Stanley High School, Chris Johnson, Principal. And our specialty school of high growth, Oakboro Choice STEM, Principal Kelly Dombrowski. So these principals will hold the coveted high growth cup for the coming year, and then we will meet back here at this time next year with our new recipients, possibly, of high growth schools.
Again, I just want to thank our administrators, our staff, our teachers, our community, and everyone. And like you said, Ms. Gibson's a great day. Thank you.
It is a great day to be a part of Stanley County Schools. Again, the board congratulates all of you. Thank you for all of your hard work.
Thank you for all that you've done throughout the year and for all you do that for our students. Board members, at this time, I'm going to provide the board a 5-minute recess for a time to have a restroom break, and also then if you want to speak to some people, and also those of you that have received awards, if you wanted to leave after we speak to you or whatever, you are welcome to do that, because that's when we get into the business part of our meeting. And this has just been great, a highlight. Thank you so much. We appreciate that, board members, that Ms. Poplin and I were summoned back up here. As you saw, we came running when you summoned us. But just to say what we were doing, so you know, if you haven't watched the video of Baden Elementary School, find it, because Mr. Rhodes, sitting back there, was doused yesterday with all kinds of green slime. And they did not go easy on him. I'm not talking about, they started with a little bucket, then the buckets got bigger, and then they were like the big containers. So he looked, Ms. Poplin said he looked like Shrek when it was all over with. So we had to talk to Mr. Rhodes a little bit. At this time, I'd like to call the board back into open session. At this time is public comments. In accordance with policy 2310, public participation at board meetings each month, part of at least one regularly scheduled board meeting, will be set aside for citizens to address the board through public comments. Each speaker will receive 3 minutes to present comments. However, the public comment session will not exceed 15 minutes total, except by majority vote of the board. I have 5 people that are signed up. The first person, Joseph, I do not know how to pronounce the last name. I'll let you say that when you come up here. And thank you for being here.
Yes, ma'am. My last name is Teddy.
Teddy.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, and allow me to speak tonight. I'll be brief. My name is Joseph Teddy. I am the CEO of Spartan Americana, a tactical training company here in North Carolina. And it goes without saying that the security and the safety of our children while attending school is a huge concern today. In 2 decades, the ability to deal with such events has still not been corrected, such as the recent Robb Elementary shooting. So what are we supposed to do? You can't stop crazy people. However, the recent shooting in Texas showed yet again that the law enforcement professionals on the ground were ill-prepared and undertrained to deal with a situation like this. This is a fact. It would take me an hour to go over the mistakes that they made. Children and teachers that were literally on the phone calling 911 for help, with over a dozen police officers outside afraid or unprepared to make entry to the school. Not only was their tactics, techniques, and procedures flawed, so was the on-site intelligence. I can tell you with 100% assurity that many children died that day that did not have to die. And that is why I am here. I am a former Force Reconnaissance Marine, Army Special Forces Green Beret, and a former operative in a highly classified government counterterrorist unit. Millions of dollars have been spent on my training. I have trained hundreds of law enforcement officers and government agents over the course of my 20-year career. Here is my bio, supporting documentation, and 8 letters of commendation and recommendation attesting to my service. Bottom line, our law enforcement officers need to take their training to the next level to deal with active shooter situations. We all know that our police departments are underfunded, and that is not a secret. This training I'm talking about is very expensive. For that reason, the men and the women that protect our communities and our schools do not receive this training. For the record, I will provide this training to any Stanley County law enforcement agency that wants it for free. I will say that again, for free. My company will absorb the entire cost associated with this training. It won't cost Stanley County a dime. This will include teaching them to conduct the police to conduct vulnerability assessments on any school in our district, as well as providing first responders how to properly enter a structure by themselves, which should be protocol for an active shooter, and deal with the threat. This training will provide them with the confidence and the ability to deal with an active shooter above and beyond their current capabilities and training. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Teddy, I think we have a question.
As head of the Safety and Community Engagement Committee, I was going to ask if I could keep this paperwork. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next person is Mr. Jason Phibbs.
Good evening, members of the board. The truth matters. The integrity of our institutions and functioning of our republic rely on the honesty and fidelity of our elected officials. And without such, the people lose confidence in those institutions and weaken their collective ability to lead. Therefore, I'm here tonight to address what I believe is the misconduct of current board member and candidate Dustin Lisk in the 2022 primary election.
Madam Chairman, our public comments do not allow individual references to personnel or students.
I've got the public policy here that talks about public comments. There's no reference to the content. It doesn't mention anything about any comments that are off limits. Is this public comments?
The comment is not. It's just the naming of personnel or students.
I'm just addressing the board.
But you named the person.
But he's a public official.
That doesn't matter.
Okay. So, but what policy are you referencing? That I can't speak.
You just can't name a person, just like a child could not be named, anyone else could not be named.
Mr. Louder, is this a school board policy, or is it a state policy, or what is it?
It's a school board policy. Been in existence for a year. You just don't name individuals.
So can I say a candidate for school board? Okay, I'll say that. All right, so therefore, I'm here tonight to address what I believe is the misconduct of a current board member and candidate. In the closing months of the primary campaign, this candidate began to assert through various channels his opposition to critical race theory. And while one could dispute the merits of such a claim, I understand that's politics. However, on the week of May 8th, this candidate sent this campaign mailer to prospective voters, which stated, he, quote, voted to oppose critical race theory, end quote. At that point, the candidate was no longer articulating his personal position, but instead what a reasonable person would assume to be the official business of the board. And such a statement, whether intended or not, gave voters the impression this board took some kind of official action. Being a frequent attendee at school board meetings for the past year, I was surprised to see such a statement. And after reading over the board meeting minutes myself and confirming with Chairwoman Gibson, I verified no such vote was held. That means this candidate's statement on the mailer was a blatant lie, not just about his role as a board member, but about the official business of the board, and misled the primary voters of Stanley County. My support for his opponent aside, I believe the candidate's actions clearly violated the Stanley County Board of Education Code of Ethics Policy 2120. The policy states, quote, all members of the board must adhere to a code of ethics, end quote, which includes, quote, the need to uphold the integrity and independence of the board member's office, the need to avoid impropriety in the exercise of the board's and board members' official duties, and take no private action that will compromise the board or administration, end quote. The candidate's actions are an affront to the people of Stanley County and undermine both the integrity of his office and this board. And while the outcome of the primary election has no bearing on the validity of this matter, it is noteworthy in this case. A post-primary poll of likely voters sponsored by the John Locke Foundation found that 78% of registered Republicans in North Carolina have an unfavorable image of critical race theory, while 48% said they believe it's currently being taught in schools. So assuming Stanley County Republicans are as conservative as those statewide, as many as 1,750 of the 2,244 people who voted for this candidate on election day could have been influenced by that mailer. That's to say nothing of the voters who heard this same message from the candidate's supporters at early voting locations. And given the candidate's slim 67 vote margin of victory, it's more than reasonable to assume this lie cost the people of Stanley County an election. Therefore, in order to uphold the integrity of this board and enforce its code of ethics policy, I ask you to pass a resolution of censure condemning the candidate's actions in the election. And while I know this won't change the outcome, it will send a message to future candidates, the voters, and the children in Stanley County schools that the truth matters. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next person is Ms. Morgan Perez.
My name is Morgan Perez. I'm a former Stanley County Schools teacher with a degree in education from ASU. My 8-year-old son is a former student at Indy Elementary School. He was enrolled in the dual language immersion program and was recently removed by the principal after almost 3 years in the class. In January, I was criminally charged with truancy. Two policemen came to my home to serve me a criminal court summons. This happened while my son and I were home. It was a traumatic experience that he will not forget. I was forced to go to district court multiple times. I was strongly encouraged by the judge to retain an attorney to avoid going to jail for 4 months. After that, I had no choice but to hire an attorney, which cost me $750. Eventually, my case was dismissed. My son had 16 unexcused absences at the time of my charge. I provided legitimate reasons in advance for each and every one of his absences. Every day that he was absent, my son completed and submitted schoolwork assignments that were provided to him by his teacher. Still, the principal criminally charged me with truancy. She did not call me or meet with me before filing the charge. In North Carolina, the attendance law states that a family can be charged with truancy when a student reaches 10 or more unexcused absences. North Carolina leaves the decision up to the local school district. Truancy charges in Stanley County are 100% principal discretion. Two students can have the same number of unexcused absences, and the principal can make the decision to criminally charge one family and not the other. As of March 2022, there have been 9 truancy charges in Stanley County schools. I have been denied updated information. According to public records from SCS, more than 900 middle and elementary school students have 10 or more unexcused absences. I'm glad that most of these families have not been criminally charged, but why was my family singled out? It is obvious that the truancy process in Stanley County is extremely inconsistent. It is unethical and unacceptable that the principal at Indy was allowed to use her position of authority to harm a student and family. Truancy charges should be a last resort for students who have chronic unexplained attendance issues or when there is suspected neglect and fear about a child's well-being. Every possible effort should be attempted to solve the attendance issue before a criminal charge is filed. I continue to think about how easy it would have been to handle my situation in a way that did not harm the school, the principal, the teacher, the parent, and most importantly, my son. Multiple court dates and $750 would be a devastating blow for many families in our community. $750 is rent or mortgage for many families. $750 is the difference between food on the table or not. An immediate revision to the SCS truancy policy and procedure is needed so that another Stanley County family does not fall victim to an unnecessary truancy charge.
Thank you. Next is Mr. Thomas Townsend.
Madam Chairman, thank you for letting me talk. Tommy Townsend. I was at the County Commissioners Board meeting last night, and Ms. Patty Crump explained to the board what the Biden administration is trying to do by withholding critical lunch money funds, federal funding for lunch money, for students that are most needy in our schools in order to pass and put forth, push his transgender agenda. He wants to force us to let boys go in girls' bathrooms and girls go in boys' bathrooms. We all know, I've taught, you've taught, many of you have taught, kids are gonna be kids. They're gonna take advantage of whatever they can, a lot of them. They need boundaries. They're gonna push those boundaries. They're gonna test it. We have many schools across our state that have already had sexual assaults in bathrooms. We're setting ourselves up to have that again if we allow this to happen in Stanley County. I don't think in a very strongly Christian oriented county, we want to push the transgender agenda on our school children. That's left to the parents, whatever they want to do at home. That should not be a school function. I did not hear when Dr. Dennis came up or Mr. List came up last night anything about when they were presenting their budget about the extra money that might be required for that, and it might be because they didn't know about it then. I know they've been working on it today some from what I hear. Is that correct, Dr. Dennis? I think you have. So that needs to be addressed. And all I'm asking is, how are you guys going to address this? Will you please let the public know how you intend to address this? Okay, we need to know what's going to happen if this goes through like it's planning, like they're trying to push it through, and they remove those federal funds for lunch money for our children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Townsend. Next is Ms. Patty Crump.
Good evening, Madam Chair, school board members. Thank you for your time. I'm just going to address what Mr. Townsend came up here and discussed. I'm doing that because I feel that it's necessary. Five of you, I believe, were at the commissioner's meeting last night, and you heard me talking with the commissioners, so I think it is the right thing to do to come and talk with you about what I talked with them about, and that was this new initiative that the Biden administration is wanting to push through. And as Mr. Townsend said, from what I have read, they announced this in May, that unless we allow boys that identify as girls use the girls' restrooms and the shower rooms and dressing rooms and all of that, and vice versa, those federal dollars that we use to help with the lunches and the dinners, the lunches and the breakfast for the kids, that will be pulled. And so I asked them that while they are negotiating with you and they're talking about their budgets, if they would please consider adding that into what they would give you this year if it does come to fruition. So, of course, we don't know that yet. We just know that there is a strong push in the Biden administration to make it happen. So I would just ask that you watch it carefully. I'm sure you will. I'm sure it concerns you just like it does me and probably all the parents in the county, or most parents in the county. I will report this, that I got a phone call from Commissioner Lawhon this afternoon right before I came. He wanted to let me know that he appreciated the information, that he'd been looking into it, talked with the county manager as well. He said that he would like to, he can only speak for himself, create a resolution from the commissioners to say that they will fight this. And he's willing to talk more about it. So just wanted to let you know that. It's very concerning. I hope it infuriates you as it does me. I'd like to know your stances on it, but I know that it's new information. So, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Crump. Next is our consent agenda. Board members, you have had time to look over the minutes from the May 3rd regular board meeting. So I would like to have a motion to approve the consent agenda, which consists of the minutes of the May 3rd meeting and the continuance of our optional mask mandate.
I make a motion. We approve the consent agenda and the mask mandate position.
Okay. I have a motion by Mr. Graves, a second.
Second.
By Ms. Poplin. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed, no. Okay, the consent agenda has been approved. Next up, we have committee reports. At this time, I'm going to call on Dr. Rufus Leffler for facilities.
We met and Mr. Todd Bowers presented us with the capital budget request for repairs that we have for our schools this coming year. And they're listed in the handout, and they amount to $3,343,000. And this is for roofs, painting, windows, window repair, just to put some Band-Aids on our buildings that we have. So if somebody would make a motion to approve the 22-23 capital budget request.
So moved.
Okay, so this is the capital budget request, Dr. Leffler. Okay, so since this is coming out of committee, then you have made the motion, okay, to approve this. Everyone sees this in your packet, and you can see what Dr. Leffler was referring to. I just need a second to approve this.
I second the motion.
Okay, a second by Mr. Graves. Any discussion?
I do have a quick question. Okay. I just want for clarification, and this could be the superintendent, Mr. Dudney, Mr. Bowers, that all of the security-related investments that come in through the quarter-cent sales tax are not included in next year's capital budget. Is that correct? That is separate, I think. I just want to confirm that. To provide just a little bit more context, if you need it, previously, the capital outlay, when Mr. Bowers would bring a budget to us, it didn't include those kinds of things. And then when we got the quarter cent sales tax passed, that was earmarked for specific items that were security related. And I just wanted to make sure, because I know from time to time, the county office will provide monies. And they say, well, you can use them however you want. Well, capital outlay has to go to capital outlay. I just want to make sure that when we make this budget request, they're not going to try and slip that quarter cent sales tax in to pay for quote unquote capital outlay. Do you understand what I'm saying?
At this point, there is no quarter cent sales tax in this capital outlay budget.
Okay, so that would come in separately.
The quarter cent sales tax at this point is being presented to be in local current expense, not capital outlay.
Okay, all right, thank you.
And answer your question, Ms. Graves. Okay. Any other discussion by board members? Okay. All in favor, please say aye. Okay. Okay.
I've got a question, Mr. Dudney. As far as the quarter cent sales tax was supposed to be for security, is that what it's going for now?
That's what it was initially on the first year that it was put into the budget for the county commissioners. It was initially put into security initiatives from the county schools. At this point, it's not coming down from the county commissioners as a security initiative. It's coming in as our current local current expense. And security initiatives fall under your capital outlay budget.
Thank you.
Okay, so then let me just jump in real quick. Just for everyone's clarification, originally the quarter cent sales tax, the school system at the time, and several members on the board now were members back then when that was passed. The superintendent at the time went out and essentially promoted, you know, this quarter cent sales tax. And it was for specific items that they had earmarked that were security and safety related. And they knew that at a certain point in time, the administration, that we were gonna satisfy all of those purchases. And so then it was going into technology, so that it would be rolled in to cover the costs, and I forget what the gap was in technology, but it was pretty substantial. I think it was like a $5 million over 3 years revolving purchase. So that's what it was for, and there were also discussions that if anything else popped up that was security related, of course it would be funded through that quarter cent sales tax. So now you just answered Dr. Leffler, and you really got me shook. Dr. Leffler, you just said capital outlay. Now you said it's coming as local expense, but security related items would have to be paid out of capital outlay?
Exactly. The based on the recommended budget for the county commissioners, the actual capital outlay initiative would, if we have any security that falls into capital outlay criteria, it would have to come out of our capital outlay budget. There is not a quarter cent sales tax being allocated to Stanley County Schools for security or any other niches other than local current expense.
Okay, and then so for Mr. Bowers, I'm not sure if any of the items, I looked at it, I didn't see any security related items on that list.
There is some security vestibules.
Oh, the vestibules,
that
right.
Under that, yes, sir.
But no, okay, not, okay, so that was all part of the original plan. Okay, great. All right, thank you so much. I just wanted to make sure that when we're submitting our request to the county commissioners, we don't miss something. That's it. So we don't have to come back and a year later, say, or 6 months later, to the public that, whoops, we missed that. Because certainly when it comes to safety-related items, and I know Ms. Poplin, this is very important to her. We just want to make sure we have all our bases covered. So thank you for that. I appreciate it.
No, we've been very diligent in making sure that we include the security. And, you know, of course, it has to come through capital, unless it's coming through a grant-funded program. But, you know, I think they've been very good with the budget, you know, Todd and Terry, and making sure that those monies are allocated properly.
Yes.
I just want to point out the quarter cent sales tax. I have not so fond memories of being out in the rain putting signs up. I was not a board member. I was just someone that cared. North Carolina has not passed a capital bond for school construction in over 30 years, and the General Assembly, North Carolina Senate, refuses to even put it up on a referendum. West Ed did a study, 2016 or 17, don't remember, $8 billion in needs in this state for exactly what we're talking about, securing and hardening our schools. So I just want everybody to understand that quarter cent sales tax is a godsend. We got cameras up, we got doors, we got secure. We're not there yet, but it's been a godsend. But at the end of the day, if the North Carolina General Assembly don't get off their butts and pass some kind of capital down this, the capital funds down this way, we're going to be in a bind. We have schools in Stanley County that are still vulnerable. We have open campus type facilities. We use that. They've been fantastic. Dudney and Bauer's been fantastic about addressing these things as we find them. I lose sleep over what happened in Texas, and I hope you did too. Don't want that coming to Stanley County. So I'm going to stand up and I'm going to defend that quarter cent sales tax like, you know, like nobody's business. But at the end of the day, your state leadership is failing your kids. 250 credible threats of school shootings in North Carolina this year. 250. Who's supposed to fund fixing our schools, making our schools secure? Okay. If you want to get technical, the North Carolina Constitution, Article 9, puts that back on the local county commission, but they passed legislation six times since then that puts it right back on Raleigh. So I'm going to stand up and defend our folks that are doing our budgeting. And I'm also going to call out the North Carolina Senate. Literally, if you ever see someone getting arrested up there for punching Phil Berger in the mouth, it's going to be me. They won't even let you vote on securing our schools. That's all I got to say.
Thank you, Mr. Sorensen. Any other discussion? Okay, we're going to take a vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay, this passes. So the capital outlay 21-22 passes. Next committee is Mr. Dustin Lisk.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We didn't have a finance meeting this month, but as most board members know, we did go speak with the county commissioners last night, mainly Dr. Dennis and Mr. Dudney. The commissioner recommended budget has came in about $1.3 million less than what we requested. And what we've requested was of that additional funds were about $600,000 to meet the state's unfunded mandate to take certain classified employees from $13 an hour to $15 an hour. The remainder was to take our teacher supplements from roughly 5% up to 6%. So we've been in certain, definitely deep conversations with the commissioners. I think Dr. Dennis has done a great job. I'd say to every employee of Stanley County Schools that these two, Mr. Dudney and Dr. Dennis, are fighting very hard for you. I do believe the commissioners are taking this very seriously and looking at ways that they can help us. So we are working together. They do have budget workshops coming out within the month. So if you do have any concerns with that, I'd ask that you express those to the commissioners in a professional, kind way. Be very supportive as they do have quite a lot of mouths to feed in Stanley County. That's pretty much it out of finance. I don't think we have any other action to take, or no action at all, actually.
Thank you. And I know that some of us were here last night, and we do appreciate you, Dr. Dennis, Mr. Lisk, Mr. Dudney. I know that you presented with our commissioners, and I know you will continue to work. I also was impressed last night that we had many of our classified people
here at that meeting too. So they are aware that we need more funding. And I was impressed that our classified workers were here at the commissioners' meeting. Thank you. Next up is instructional program, Mr. Bill Sorensen.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. We met on the 26th on three items. Career Accelerator, which Dr. Amy Blake will be glad to explain and let y'all fill y'all in on that. Summer Bridge, which is another program, it's a crucial program to our instructional program. And a CTE local plan, which we have to act on. I would ask Dr. Amy Blake to go ahead and do her presentation so we could vote on the local action plan after you've talked to the other two items. Is that okay?
I can, if you want to, Mr. Sorensen, I'll just wait and we'll get through the committee reports and then I'll let Ms. Okay. Amy Blake Lewis come up and do her part.
You've got to vote on that.
Is that okay with you, Dr. Amy Blake Lewis?
Yes, ma'am, perfectly fine.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Sorensen, for that report. Marketing, community engagement, safety, Ms. Carl Poplin.
Yes, I didn't have a official committee meeting this month, but I have met individually with Ms. Melissa Smith. Guys, excuse my voice. I was sick a few weeks ago and it has not come back to me. Ms. Melissa Smith and Ms. Jennifer Flo, and I might just have a few updates for the board, if that's all right. When talking with Ms. Flo, with all the events that we've had going on with our schools, I just wanted to check in with her on our safety situations and how things were going. So she has a Safe Schools grant that she was able to secure for $52,000, and cameras have been ordered this week and starting next week throughout our county. They'll be replacing any that have any kind of damage or issue and adding additional cameras at the ones that have requested that they need an additional camera for a specific spot. We have a graduation safety plan in place. She's also working on a grant for some additional campus security. And as soon as the SRO grant becomes available, they plan to apply for as many positions as possible with that. And then when speaking with Ms. Melissa Smith, when it comes to community engagement, there was an event that was held a few days ago called Women Making a Difference at the Yorey Bank Conference Center. And so it was for women and daughters, and Ms. Smith emceed that event. And she just wanted to thank those groups that came together to get that going. A big thank you to Dusty Laney and Skate City for sponsoring those nice trophies that we had tonight. That was something Melissa was able to acquire and get going for us. And so we just really want to give them a thank you for the High Growth Schools Awards. And we're also in the works for an Albemarle therapy farm. So we'll be working with local businesses and farms. And if anyone is interested in assisting or participating with this, you can contact Stanley County Schools and Melissa Smith or myself. We're trying to get that at Albemarle High School, I believe it is. I don't know if Melissa's still here. I think that's right. Is that correct? Okay. And then the last thing I have for that is we also have a senior send-off for graduating students this year that the Stanley Montgomery Baptist Association and the Stanley Dreamers are helping us get some little gift packages together for our seniors to send them off to college. So that's all I have. Thank you.
That's really neat. I like that. And there was a grand opening, right? Like last week or something.
Yes.
Some of us attended.
Then Nehemiah Project had the Growing Minds Mentoring Center grand opening last week also, yes. That a lot of board members attended, and that is going to be for primarily East and Central this summer, but then they're going to try to expand that to other areas also.
When did you say those students can start there?
They're taking pre-registrations now, and I believe they're going to start June 20th is the start date.
Very good. Thank you for that report. Personnel, Ms. Vicki Watson.
Thank you. We met on May 18th, and most of our things were in closed session on some contracts and different things, but we have two things we need to vote on tonight, and this is one of them. I move that the Stanley County Board of Education approve a one-year extension to the superintendent's contract with a new end date of June 30th, 2026, as outlined in Amendment 2.
Okay, so you are making a motion, okay, that extends Dr. Dennis's contract for 1 year. And that runs through, what did you say?
June 30th of 2026.
June 30th of 2026. Okay, we have a motion on the floor that's coming out of Personnel Committee.
I second.
Okay, we have a second by Mr. Sorensen. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, no. Okay, that has passed.
Thank you. And then another one, I move that the Stanley County Board of Education approve the Deputy Associate Superintendent contract for Dr. Amy Blake Lewis.
So coming out of your committee is to approve the Deputy Assistant Superintendent contract for Dr. Amy Blake Lewis. Okay, that's coming out of committee. We have a motion then. I need a second.
A second.
A second by Mr. Graves. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, no. Okay, that has been approved.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Policy, Ms. Carla Poplin.
Well, surprisingly, I have no report.
Are you serious? Did I hear that right?
No report.
Never happens. Thank you. I think now, Dr. Amy Blake Lewis, I'm going to turn things over to you with curriculum and instruction.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I will ask Mandy Melton to please join me. We do have, as Mr. Sorensen said, coming from committee, the required approval of our local CTE plan. This is an annual approval process. So those of you who have been members of the board should feel familiar with this. But I've asked Ms. Melton to just hit the high points for the board members who are not members of the instructional committee.
Like Ms. Blake Lewis stated, this is something that we have to complete annually. But part of this plan, every 2 years, we are required to conduct a comprehensive needs assessment. And this was the year of the comprehensive needs assessment. So we gather data through a variety of channels, teacher advisories, business advisories, teacher externships, stakeholder surveys, student surveys, our career development and course planning projects. And through that data gathering process, made decisions on how to address the data performance indicators that are outlined by the state, such as the four-year graduation rate of CTE concentrators, academic proficiency in language arts, mathematics, and science with CTE concentrators, post-secondary placement of CTE concentrators, non-traditional enrollments in CTE courses, scores on CTE post-assessments, and quality obtained post-secondary credentials. That's a mouthful. And the plan, you guys have an executive summary in your packet and a copy of the presentation that was given at the instructional committee meeting.
I would like to highlight one of the things that Ms. Melton has been able to do in leveraging her CTE budget is to expand the role of our CDCs. Ms. Melton, if you'd like to share that.
We were allocated an increase in months of employment, and based on the recommendation from DPI, we will now be able to employ a career development coordinator in each feeder pattern. So there will be one career development coordinator that will be responsible for the middle and high school together in each feeder pattern. Right now we have one career development coordinator serving two high school, two middle, in the western and southern part of the county, and then the other career development coordinator serving four schools in the northern and the Albemarle district. So we are looking forward to that. I think it's a great opportunity for our students. It's a great opportunity for us to expand our internships and our kids out in the community working.
Well, questions? We can ask, okay.
You can.
Go ahead.
Just on that, is that a semi-permanent thing now?
Reduction in months of employment is very rare, and we received a substantial increase enough to cover that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but that's not like, so that's not one time or?
No.
Okay, cool.
These funds are not like ESSER funds.
Right,
these
right.
are typically recurring every mm-hmm. year in annual
okay, great.
CTE budget.
Great, that's great. With anything, we don't have to go to the county commissioner's
right.
for is
no,
a good thing.
Correct.
Okay, great.
Yes. Months of employment are allotted based on ADM, so withstanding a significant decrease in ADM, we should
great, thank you
be
so
fine.
Much.
So this is up for board approval. I would ask Madam Chair that you take action.
Okay, so this is to give you approval for, this is our 2022-23
local CTE plan.
Okay, 2022-23 local CTE plan.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and I had one thing before I asked for a motion. I know that you've given us a copy. I was even at that meeting, but you have a PowerPoint. Is there a way of sending that PowerPoint to each board member that
yes.
you have here?
Yes, ma'am. I'll it's, make sure that happens.
You know, it's hard to see this here, and I remember it. Yeah, I would like to
yes, ma'am.
See that
mm-hmm.
again.
We'll make
as
sure
well.
That happens.
Mm-hmm. Okay, board members, so I need a motion to approve the 2022-23 CTE local plan.
Madam Chair, I move that we approve the 2022-2023 local CTE funding plan.
Okay, I have a motion by Mr. Sorensen, a second. A second by Mr. Graves. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Well, any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay, this has passed.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Thank both of you. Next up, we have Auxiliary Services, Mr. Dudney.
Okay, good evening. I'm going to call Michaela Mabry up here with me just to go over the first two items that's on the agenda. Excuse me. First thing is we're wanting to talk about our child nutrition bids for the 2022-2023 school year. So, Michaela.
Good evening. This year we had a renewal with our Gordon Food Service. The renewal contract went up to $2,024,062.26 for that's just our food. Our supplies went up to $129,655.15. That was our renewal. For bid purposes, we had to go out for bid for produce, milk, and chemicals. So for produce, we had R&H. We generally go with them anyways, but they did not decline our bid this time. So the bid for them is $119,392.50. For milk, we went out for bid. Stanley Dairy did not decline. The bid is for $297,520. And then chemicals, we're also with Alco again, and the bid for them is $30,865.70.
So how much of an increase is that over last year?
For our food and supplies?
Yeah, all of them. I mean, what percentage did it go up?
Well, for our food and supplies from Gordon's, it went up $800,000 for both food and supplies.
Based on the same quantity?
Yes, sir.
So it's at 2.02 million, right? 2,022,000.
Yes, sir.
And that's up 800,000 from last year.
Yes, sir.
Same thing happens at the grocery store.
We can thank the grocery store cost. You can see that in your personal pocketbooks at home, and also the cost of fuel too.
So how do we get that funded?
That will actually be funded through the reimbursements that we would get from the federal government, as well as any supplemental sales that we're allowed to sell next year. And that is to where we the child nutrition services can go back in full-blown with supplemental sales next year, because of that had been put on the burner because of on the back burner because of COVID. So based on what revenues she receives from the federal government, any local revenues from supplemental sales, and then anything that the board approves in our budget for next year, that will be where it covers the excess cost.
Is there a percentage breakdown between, so we get federal reimbursement for some of the breakfasts and lunches, and prior to COVID, what was our percentage? I know during COVID it was like 100% the federal government, I think, was reimbursing, but if it wasn't 100%, it was different than pre-COVID. And now we're going back to what we hope to be more like pre-COVID percentages, right? As far as reimbursements versus students that are paying.
Yes, sir.
What's that approximate percentage breakdown? Do you know?
What I would roughly prefer to do is to actually get that information back to y'all.
Okay.
For that, because that was something even prior to me, because I came on in April when COVID started in March. So the first year I was here was really already skewed because of that.
Mm-hmm.
So let me and Michaela work on those figures for you, as well as the next line item is something that's on the agenda that we're actually going to be talking about that might could help us with increase our revenue sources for next year.
Madam Chair, Michaela, if I'm not mistaken, the supplemental sales being able to come back in this year will help you drastically. Is that not correct? If you're not aware, those are the extra items that they sell in the cafeteria. Not coffee.
Well, wait a minute, though.
When
you said coffee, didn't we try something 1 year at South Stanley High School that was a big hit?
Well, I don't
and it
know.
Was coffee.
I didn't know that.
Well, it was coffee.
Yeah,
it was.
It was very popular.
Was
the kids
juice.
Thought it was coffee. Everybody was drinking it.
Okay. Well, it was kind of those latte things, wasn't it?
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Okay. It was what?
It was juice.
Yeah.
Ooh. Well, I didn't mean that, but I mean.
To
I'm
cut
sorry.
This out of the video.
That just sales took away my latte there. Okay.
Anyway, those items drastically help. And during COVID, I know that we took a big hit because we were unable to have those being sold. So just.
And another thing, just to throw out there, was it March? March, the state allowed us to start serving two entrees. During COVID, it was one entree. So we have seen an increase in our revenues in the last 2 months for that.
And starting next year, we're going to be offering as a pre-COVID where you have up to three entrees, except for your high schools, you have a few more choices as well.
You know, those of us that went and worked one day in the cafeteria, are you still recovering from it? I mean, that was an experience, and because I realized how hard those cafeterias ladies work, and men. But what I'm wondering is, how do we get that push now that it seems like everything, what you're talking about, the supplemental items and everything, how can we get more of a push here to get more students eating in the cafeteria?
I'll let you go. You go ahead.
Well, that's where what we'll be discussing next. We're wanting to implement a newer idea for more schools to have more of a chance to try to boost sales a little bit.
I would love to see that, and I appreciate all the work that you are doing with that. I just think it's something that, you know, I go into the cafeterias, you know, sometimes or with my little ones, and you know, I would love to see more, you know, more eating and whatever creative things you do to get them to eat lunch.
We've actually, in with our supplies, we've added some new menu items that will be starting next year, some new breakfast items and lunch items as well. So hopefully we can draw a little bit more there as well.
That's great. Okay, thank you.
As long as you don't get rid of the hot chips for all my little lunch buddies, we'll be good.
I had the fiestada today at Millenport. It was delicious.
Good.
Just keep that on the menu.
Yeah, everybody
that was
has
a hard
to have
one
the fiestada.
To come
right. What do we need to do now with this child nutrition bid?
You will need to actually approve that. We'll need both a motion and first and second.
Okay.
On that.
So I need a motion to approve the 2022-23 child nutrition bid.
I make a motion we approve the 22-23 child nutrition bid.
Okay, a motion by Ms. Poplin, a second by Ms. Watson. I think we've already had discussion, many of us. So all in favor say aye. Any opposed, no. Okay, this carries. Thank you.
Okay, and if we'll go right on into the second line item there when it talks about child nutrition CEP schedule. CEP, rather, for those that doesn't know what that stands for, is community eligibility provision that was put into place in 2014 to where school systems could opt in to offer if a school's meets the criteria based on direct certification that we could offer to all kids free at our schools. So Michaela and I have sat down. Currently, we have four schools that are participating in CEP. That is East Albemarle Middle School, Central Elementary School, and of course the Stanley Academy. We've tried to come and work in a way to where we could increase our availability there to offer more CEP to our students in Stanley County. So what we've come up with in the presentation tonight is that we would be able to offer all elementary schools in Stanley County. They meet the criteria if we group them together to where they would meet the threshold for the community eligibility provision. So we will ask for all elementary schools to be CEP as well as Albemarle High School and Albemarle Middle School. Albemarle High School has not been in that mix with Central East and Albemarle Middle School, and so they meet the criteria for that this year individually. On the offset of that, you have to compare what your traditional reimbursement would be at an estimated number of meals versus what your CEP reimbursement would be. CEP, once you become CEP, your reimbursement is greater than it would be if you were just traditional. So we do have three locations. When we talk about those 14 schools, we have three locations that the traditional reimbursement would be a slight higher than what our CEP reimbursement would be. We had that this year with a couple of schools, and what you have to do as a local board is supplement that difference. So this current year, our amount was around $13,000 is what we had to put in the budget for the child nutrition support. What I'm presenting to y'all tonight is in order for us to have these four schools is in the CEP and to be able to offer more students in Stanley County to be able to eat free and to be able to increase our revenue source because CEP would be a higher reimbursement rate. Our local funds would be somewhere in the $19,000 that we would have to set aside. That would be in the leaflet that I've gave Hope to put in your packet. For all elementary schools, we would look at roughly about $9,000 of that $19,000 we would have to come into local budget, but that would certify all of the 11 elementary schools until for four more years, so just 2025-26, so they could stay CEP for that duration. Albemarle High School would not be any local funds we'd have to worry about for Albemarle High School. That would absolutely put them in there for the same four-year term, 2025-26. Albemarle Middle School, we would have to come up with about $11,000. And that was one of the schools also for this year, so along with the academy. So based on what I'm presenting to y'all tonight, I would ask that you approve that we offer this CEP to those 14 individual schools, and that we set aside the roughly $19,000 in our local budget to offset the cost of the reimbursement from traditional to federal CEP for child nutrition program.
Let me just give a little context too, that you know the free meals that have been afforded to us, that ends. So that's going away. Mm-hmm. So it's important that we have the CEP at as many schools that are eligible.
Yeah.
So just for clarification, you said that all 11 elementary schools would have the free breakfast and lunch.
Free breakfast and lunch.
I just wanted to make sure that's what I was hearing.
And just
wonderful.
To add to that, too, when we compare, when we have to offer children a meal to eat, okay, whether they can afford it or not. That's federal law. So when a child doesn't eat, or when a child eats and doesn't have the opportunity of paying for that if they do not meet the free and reduced, then that actually adds up with charge meals. The child nutrition program at the end of the year cannot have any balance in charge meals. So that has to be encumbered by either the school itself or either the school system itself. So we've had that last year. We had charge meals that the schools had to clear up. And this year we have the same, we'll end up probably with the same thing. So this sort of helps alleviate some of that with this schools. Now, we tried to look at all schools across the board, but I think what we need to do is just sort of ease ourselves into it and see where we can go from year to year to year by adding more if possible.
I've got a question. Mm-hmm. By doing this, we're not wasting food, are we? I mean, is this every kid gets a meal? I mean, how much food are we throwing away doing this if we do it this way?
It would be the same as any other year. The kid would have a choice to come through the line. They don't necessarily have to come through the line, so if they brought their lunch, they wouldn't have to come through the line. We account for that every time. If we end up with leftover food, we do try to serve it the next day so we don't waste it or have to throw it away.
Majority of the time, the students that are taking advantage of this are students that don't meet that free and reduced criteria, but also don't have money for a lunch. So this is very big for our elementary schools.
Okay, so we are needing a motion then to transition 14 of our schools to become CEP schools and to set aside $19,000.
It's a little over 19,000.
Okay, a little over that. Okay, when needed or if needed.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we approve to set aside the funds for these 14 schools to become CEP schools.
Okay, a motion by Ms. Poplin. Can I have a second? Second by Mr. Lisk. Any further discussion?
Mr. Dunne, you said that it was going to be approximately $9,000 to cover the 11 elementary schools, but it was going to be $11,000 for just Albemarle Middle. Why so much more for Albemarle
Middle? Me and Michaela has had that same discussion, so I'll let her sort of just give you an understanding of what that is.
So, and with Albemarle Middle School, they automatically qualify for CEP for their direct certification numbers. And with that, with them already being CEP, we technically have to still offer them CEP status by our USDA guidelines. Their numbers kind of drop a little bit their direct certification numbers dropped just a touch this year when I inputted them in versus years the last time they were recertified. So that made them drop down a little bit into where traditional funding is a little higher than their CEP.
How many years is this? Or is this just for next year?
No, this is for four years.
4 years.
It's for 4 years. And so if we're voting on this plan right now, we have the ability to, I just want to make sure that the board is not getting into a situation where if something does happen down the road and the federal government, the USDA, tries to force our hands through policy when we accept this money, I want to make sure that we have the ability to say, hold on a second, we're going to take the money. We're not necessarily going to go along with that. Mm-hmm. We want to work with the county commissioners and possibly the state to fight any potential encroachment like that. So as long as we have that ability, I'm happy to vote for this.
And just to let you know, this when you opt into the CEP provision, it can go for 4 years. Okay, but that doesn't mean that you every year you can reevaluate your school system, right, to see what, if there's any you can add or any that actually could actually fall out, but it doesn't necessarily mean they have to be removed. They can, they're grandfathered in for the term.
And is there anyone that verifies our qualification for CEP? Is there like a, is there a standard like form you fill out for each school that shows that each school qualifies? Okay. Yes. And is that a state form or is that a federal USDA form?
That's done through the state with the direct certification process through DSS.
Oh, right, direct certification. Okay, all right, thanks. Appreciate it.
And we did find out today that in that, actually, in that direct certification, they're allowing now that any child that actually receives Medicaid can also be in the low-income status for that as well. That has not been an initiative that has been used in the past, so we did get that notification today. Because there can be students out there that actually receive Medicaid but not necessarily be a food stamp recipient in the home. Okay?
Do you foresee this with any of our other middle schools?
Yes, ma'am.
So you foresee that possibly we can add to this? And I am concerned like elementary and middle.
Okay. And we did try to work at the end to try to pull in the other three middle schools mm-hmm. into the figure. Mm-hmm. What ends up happening is that it causes your formula to be a little skewed mm-hmm. because, of course, you know, not to go into a lot of the poor and all that kind of stuff right. and rich and all that kind of stuff, right. but it did cause it to skew it a little bit more than not at this time. But as we evaluate it as we go, that's what our plans are.
I appreciate you presenting this to us, and I would appreciate if you can kind of keep us abreast of, you know, how this is going.
We will.
Okay. We've had a motion, we've had a second, we've had discussion. All in favor say aye. Any opposed, no. Okay, this has passed.
Thank you, Michaela.
Okay,
the next line item I have on the agenda is insurance bid proposals. Finally, we've got there. Y'all asked several months ago, this was an issue that we could not get done last year, but you asked that we go out to bids on our insurance offerings for our workers' comp, our auto liability insurance, our general liability for our staff, as well as our errors and omissions liability. We went out to request for proposals. We received two proposals from insurance companies. You'll see I gave, it's in y'all's packet, the two insurance companies. One is our current insurance company. The other one that's pretty much out there and about in the state that services schools. I did a breakdown based on all the categories that we have coverage. And you'll see where we start out at commercial property. That's actually the two facilities, the central office. We have, even though we rent the facility from the county, we cover our equipment. As well as the barn that we use, that we rent and lease from in the southern part of the county. So that's where that falls. You'll see there's pretty much not that much of a difference there in what our coverage is. And then the premiums for all these coverages are in bold. So as I go through, if you have any questions, feel free to stop me. On page one, you'll also see the general liability. That's covers a whole gamut of things, and you'll see I pretty much listed those items under there. Both policy, insurance policy companies pretty much had the same limits of liabilities that's pretty much across the state with all school systems. So you'll see that was all, they're all included, and you'll see what the difference in the premiums in that category was. School board legal and errors and omissions. We have we had that pulled out separately by one of the insurance companies. The other one is actually included in the general liability line item. So that's why you don't see anything under the first insurance company. If you flip over to page two, you'll see commercial inland marine. That is our lawnmowers, our tractors, and stuff of that sort. That's not boats and jet skis, okay? So I did want to make sure that we are on the same page there. But you'll see that's pretty much what the limits there, and then there what the premiums amounts on those two items. Our next item was business automobile. That is all our fleet vehicles, athletic buses, our cars, our truck, maintenance trucks, anything other than the yellow buses. This don't have anything to do with yellow buses. And you'll see that a lot of both companies have the same things included there with the limits of liabilities, and there's not a lot of difference in the premium cost in that area. Commercial umbrella is the next thing. That's pretty much everything that can go wrong, that's where it's covered, okay? So you'll see that pretty much both insurance companies covers a lot of your occurrences that can happen in that, under that area, when it comes to personal injury or anything for, related to a student being injured on campus or at our fault or anything of that sort. So anything for exceptional children could fall under that category as well. And you'll see the premium amounts there. On page three, this is a big thing in the push across the state. It's been there for several years, and it's dealing with cyber security. We have three different areas there. The three different areas there that was broke down by one of the insurance companies. The other one just pretty much calls it a cyber suite. So I wanted to break them down individually so you could see what the limits and stuff of that sort of was. There's not a lot of difference. They pretty much cover about each equal things. It's just the way it's broke out. You have one is calling it data compromise coverage, one is called and the identity recover, cyber coverage, and then the other one just covers it all. It calls it cyber suites. And on the last page, workers' comp, you'll see that they're pretty much both are equal there, same limits, and cover a lot of the same things with workers' comp. The total line, that's the total difference in the two premium cost for all this coverage. I gave y'all client references under that based on other school systems that these insurance companies provide services to, or community colleges, or local governments, or county governments. So there's roughly about $36,000, $37,000 difference in the premium total premium cost. So we would ask for y'all's to make a decision on which route you would like to go. One is actually a local vendor. The other one is one that's actually from the Surrey County area.
Mr. Dunning.
Yes.
Are we expected to, is this gonna work similar to other insurances where there's built-in increases every year? Just for the same exact coverage?
You will probably see some. I've not seen a lot in my tenure. I mean, the only thing, workers' comp is that's a moving target. It depends on how many claims you have. There's a 3-year window for workers' comp that you can, depending on how many claims you have, the actual type of claim it is in workers' comp could cause your workers' comp premium to be adjusted. But I haven't seen that much of a difference when it comes to like general liability and stuff of that sort. Most of the time, if you have big claims, you can cause premium the increase in that. But workers' comp is a 3-year window. So if we have extraneous amount of workers' comp claims and then there's big payouts on workers' comp, that can cause your mod rating to can skew your premium.
Are we getting a break for having a safety officer?
That it was asked, and one of the insurance companies asked what kind of safety initiatives we had. I said we have a safety officer, we have safety protocols. So they didn't pretty much say that was good or that was bad. But you do find that a lot of instances when you put things in place like that, that you do get some kind of credits against your premium on that stuff.
I have a couple questions here. I noticed in the data compromise defense, that's $50,000. And I mean, there are obviously different legal matters that we have to deal with. Is that saying that they would, if there was a situation where we had data compromised through any of our cloud apps or staff related apps, where we're storing that information, that we would only have, if a suit was brought against the school system, we'd only have a coverage of they would only cover $50,000 in legal fees? Do you know, maybe Mark would even have that's on page, I think page 3. It is.
25,000 for a legal review. That's all
No, a data compromise defense. Like, for example, as we know, lawyers are very particular. So if it says that this is the coverage for data compromise defense and somebody steals somebody's lunch, the lawyers aren't going to, we're going to have to pay for that out of our pocket. But if it's data compromise defense, they're going to give us $50,000. So my question is, if that's the case, is there any indemnification through the use of any of our tools? And I'm not sure you can even answer this now, but if you can't, we need to go back and research what level of responsibility as far as liability goes. Do the companies, the vendors of the various tools that we use, what do they cover? And what's our exposure? Because this is becoming more and more of a problem. There's some things that we'll probably need to talk about in closed session related to this. And so I just want to make sure that we're covered.
Okay, and that's something I can address with Sean on the technology side of things on that for data breaches.
This is a standard, so I think it's fine, but we need to look into that because maybe none of the policies are covering what they should.
Right. A lot of what I understand, a lot of your cyber solution policies that are being offered out there is a standard, but there's always, you can add more to the limits of that.
Well, what is the difference in the $36,000 difference? I mean, it looks like it said county schools on the company we're with now is 81 references, and then the new company, one reference, and then the colleges and community colleges, it seemed like on the new one, they have more. I mean, have you talked to some of the references or anybody about these companies?
And I just noticed something. I want to apologize. That is reversed. Those columns are reversed. I apologize for that. The 81 county schools actually go under the Surrey insurance. I'm sorry. Yes, on the county schools, yes. And I just noticed that. I'm sorry.
So we're the only county school that our company has?
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are.
Huh.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Do you know anything about insurance?
You need it when you got it. That's about all.
No, we need to have somebody review this and kind of give us an idea. I mean, do you, Dr. Dennis, or anybody?
I'll say this. We went over it earlier. I mean, a lot of it's like Mr. Graves, a lot of it's standard.
Is a standard thing.
I do know that can I borrow you? Well, we had it marked up. So I do know this, though, just based on and being a superintendent, knowing, you know, what little I know about insurance. But the one company, and I know y'all talked about this, which is Surrey, is very popular amongst counties. And the reason is they do provide good coverage, from my understanding of working with other counties, and they do have good premiums, and they're very well priced. That's why they're in a lot of different districts, because I know a lot of districts, you know, the RFP, their insurance on a regular basis. So that's all I really can tell you about it.
Within the for Mr. Ladder, within the school systems here in North Carolina, what's your track record? Do you know? Can you speak to that? Have you heard anything anecdotally about Surrey's track record?
I can't. I've not heard anything.
Right. I
would add that most of the school systems in the past, and we once did, we belonged to what's called the trust. And at some point several years ago, with a different board, board decided that they wanted to go with an insurance company that would actually pay out more in claims, because the trust had a certain immunity in that it was not deemed insurance, and you don't have to pay out if you don't have insurance. That's why they called it the trust. But several years ago, our then existing board decided we didn't want to do that, because, in other words, if parents did not pay for like insurance on their own at the beginning of the year, I think that's still offered on a countywide basis. Then if they just sued the school, they wouldn't get anything, because we didn't have any insurance to cover that. It was in a trust. See, the the difference. And you might call it semantics, but it was there was an appellate court case that determined that. And most of the school systems several years ago, and I think it might still be true, belong to that trust.
The school board trust dropped out of the workers' comp insurance coverage several years ago.
Right.
They have just started offering workers' comp insurance in the last couple of years. But they had dropped out of that, and that initiative is really where a lot of school systems went out and said, well, we've got to bid out our workers' comp, so we would bid out our general errors and omissions and our auto liability and stuff of that sort.
Madam Chair, are you ready for a motion?
Well, I thought we had a motion.
Oh, yes.
We're having a discussion.
Well, do you?
I just have one. We don't have the luxury of a July meeting, so what's the timetable here? So, like, if somebody had asked, well, can we get some?
Our insurance expires July 1st.
Oh, that answers that. That
okay.
And you say these are the only two options we have as far as?
This was the only two that has offered RFP.
Okay. I mean, you've had great questions. I mean, I've been looking over things, and so, yes, I think we need to make a decision. What?
I'll make a motion to approve the Surrey insurance policy. It's about 20% lower with coverage, and we will join the other 81 counties.
I will second that motion.
I have a motion by Mr. Lisk to join the Surrey insurance, a second by Ms. Poplin. Is there any more discussion? Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Okay, this has carried then.
Okay, thank you. And just to make you a comment, I have worked with Surrey Insurance Company before in the past. That does not make me make a decision for them here. I just want to make that record straight. I didn't have anything to do with that. I just took the data and created it for y'all on y'all's behalf. But they do offer a lot of other services that we normally, that we do not have in our camp, in our school system. They have free of charge, they have individuals that will come and train our classified staff on proper protocols for safety. Cafeteria staff and custodians are one of the biggest categories in workers' comp that can cause your rating to be so high because of the injuries, because of the kind of work they do. So they can actually come at no charge at the beginning of every year and do a training session or to those individuals, as well as they could do training sessions to anybody when it comes to certain safety protocol. So they have that. They have an actual person that works strictly with workers' comp claims. She is a retired individual from Roanne Salisbury Schools that works one-on-one with any kind of workers' comp claims. So there's a lot of other things they give and bring to the table. So I just want to put that out there for y'all.
Thank you.
Okay, and the last thing I have is the actual is the surplus items for sale. You'll see there's a list of items that that's been out of service for quite a while, and so we're actually going to be putting those items on Gov Deals at your approval. So we ask that you recommend that we sell these surplus items.
Okay, I need a motion from the board to sell these surplus items.
I make a motion that we sell the surplus items on the list Mr. Dunning has provided.
Okay, I have a motion by Ms. Poplin, a second. Second by several. Okay, any discussion about this? All in favor say aye. Any opposed, no. Okay, this is carried.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I think we are at superintendent comments. Dr. Dennis.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I know it's getting late, so I'll be brief. Just a couple things I want to bring up. You know, it goes without saying, thoughts and prayers are with the school community in Uvalde, Texas, with that tragedy, and of course, with the student tragedy we had here in our county as well. The last day of school is tomorrow. It's a half day. Please remember, we have graduations on the 7th and the 8th. I hope you all have a schedule. If you guys don't have a schedule, then I'll get you one. I'm sorry, I wrote it. 9th to 10th. 9th to 10th. 9th to 10th. Sorry, 9th to 10th. 9th to 10th. I was doing something else. I was actually numbering that, 9th and 10th. All apologies. Another thing is I was asked, and I want to give the board an update. I did speak to Michaela because of some questions. As you know, there is government's looking at making adjustments to Title IX, and some language that's going to be put in that would address gender equality, and ask her how that affected or how they were being told it was going to affect child nutrition. Right now, and you correct me if I'm wrong, I think my understanding is there's some federal documents that will have to be amended based on language that gets changed. But at this juncture, we're not aware of anything else that is going to be impacted by any changes to that. We will continue to monitor the situation, and if there are any changes or we see anything coming down, then we'll make sure that the board knows post-haste. And the very last thing I want to say, again, congratulations to all the people that it goes without saying that we were able to recognize today, students, teachers, staff, and, just administration, everyone. But I think that there's a testament when you looked in this room and you looked at what we were doing, that the public schools are the best option. There's no doubt about it. I don't know any other institution where you have the amount of people in a community to come together. And you've got these champions, you've got these artists, you've got these educators, and all these different people that come together, and what they provide, the services they provide, the care they provide, and I think what our students glean from it is just a testament to how strong public education is, and how public education is the bedrock of the community in education. And it's obvious, it's not just the schools. I mean, it takes the community, it takes the parents. I'm not taking anything away from that, but all together, the strength just shows, as you see these students here, just how powerful it is. And of course, I may be biased, I've been in it for a long time. I'm a product of public education, and so are my kids, so is all my family. And it's just something I truly believe in, and it was just great today to see the fruits of all our labors. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dennis. I certainly echo everything that you've said. I'm going to start with Dr. Leffler, please, with board member comments.
I agree with Dr. Dennis. Tonight, to see all the parents and family members and community here, it's good to see at the end of the year, this is what's been produced this year. And this isn't all of it, this is just a small part of it. And it's also great to see this year is the first year we've got back close to normal, and all the progress that's been made in everything, in the educational process, the growth, the athletes, the people that are athletes. I was just on the team. I never won any award. I was just at the end of the bench. But it's great to see all these people recognized, and it's the academics, the athletics, our teachers, our principals, our custodians, our bus drivers, everybody. It depends on all of them. Everybody has to pull together. And I think tonight was just a testament to everything that the school system stands for, and public education, and just public life in general. I mean, you can't just stay in one little group of people your whole life. You have to deal with everybody in the community and everybody in the world. And I think tonight was just a testament of what's going on in our community and all the efforts that are being made. Everybody have a wonderful time off from school, but do not forget to still do the reading and math 3 days of the week, maybe instead of every day. But we don't want to forget what we learned during this year.
Thank you, Dr. Leffler. Mr. Graves.
Thank you. It was really cool seeing the paper. That's why I ran out to get it before our meeting. And hopefully we can get a signed copy for the central office, the County of Champions. I picked it up and I saw it, and I was like, wow, this is pretty cool that the SNAP had the opportunity to do basically an entire front page on our softball champions. And of course they had already done a story about our golf team as well too, which is great. And it's one of the things when you look back, I know probably everyone's gonna agree, when you think back to your time in school, it's not about tests and it's not about particular subjects, but it's about your coaches and teachers and classmates, that you remember fondly. And a lot of people are going to have some very fond memories of this year, no doubt. For a second year in a row, I was also surprised that a gentleman won for Principal of the Year. That's I think it's a record. I don't know if it's a trend, but it's a record, because there's very, very tough competition that they were going up against. And once again, that was pretty amazing. So congratulations to everyone. On the safety and security side, I thought that was amazing that the speaker who got up, Mr. Tedai, that he's made that offer. I'm sure that word's going to get back to Sheriff Crisco about that, as well as various police chiefs around the municipalities here in Stanley County. That's really, really cool. I was even thinking before he offered to do it for free, but he offered to do it for free, and we have it on record about maybe even donating some money to the to that, because it's very difficult and funding is tough. And I know that all of our law enforcement officers would love to take advantage of free training like that, especially from someone as qualified as him. So that's fantastic. I want to thank our other speakers. There's some topics that maybe we can touch on in a future meeting, but I want to just reserve the remainder of my time to encourage our staff of Stanley County Schools to please, as Chairwoman Gibson suggested, and other individuals up here, reach out and contact your elected officials who are county commissioners, encourage them to support fully funding the budget that was presented to the county commissioners this year. It is very, very, very important. The county commissioners look at participation like we had last night to gauge how important it is to the public. And if it's directly impacting you and your paycheck, you are the individuals that they want to see come out. In years past, when the boards fought very hard to try to increase funds for pay, we did not have a public turnout. We had three people, and I won't repeat them again tonight, but we had three people show up, and two were not teachers, they were administrators. One was Melissa Smith, I will point her out, because she's always supporting everyone, and also Melissa Bell, too, who's always here. So please, show solidarity. If you can get together and do a very positive show of appreciation for the county commissioners that are going to support the school budget, I would encourage you to do that. And I'm sure you can get that information on the county calendar. If not, I'm sure you can reach out to folks in the central office to get information about those budget work sessions that the county commissioners are going to participate in. Thank you.
That was brief. Wow. Wait a minute. Let me look at my clock, my time. Mr. Lisk.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We certainly have a lot to be proud of with Stanley County Schools, the championships, all the recognitions tonight. I think the recent Cognia scores shows that Dr. Blake Lewis and staff are doing a very good job. Our teachers are doing a great job. Every employee of Stanley County Schools has us moving in the right direction, in my opinion. And as I understand it, our integrated testing so far is going extremely well. So I'm very excited to see how that turns out. So thank you to all of you and Dr. Blake Lewis. I will mention and kind of give a shout out to our representative in the North Carolina State House, Wayne Sasser, who did submit our resolution of the school calendar flexibility. I can't remember the exact meeting we did that, but what that meant was to move the start date no later than the closest Monday to August the 15th. And Mr. Sasser did submit that for us, and I believe today it was approved out of one of the House local government committees, and I think it goes to another committee hearing, but it is moving through the House. So if you do come across Mr. Sasser, thank him. That is common sense legislation. Thank you. Joint with the commissioners. Okay, so there you go. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lisk. Ms. Poplin?
I just kind of want to echo everything everyone else has said. I appreciate Wes Tucker and the West Stanley High School students for that performance. I was ill and I missed Mamma Mia, and I was informed tonight that there's a DVD, so I may be requesting one of those, because that was just very, very good, and I enjoyed it. I also want to give a little shout out to a young lady that was at the South Stanley championship game. Her name is Holly, and she has blonde hair. That's about all I know. But she should have got MVP of rally team for the audience. I don't know her, but she does a wonderful job. I really enjoyed being able to go and watch.
She's the mascot running around.
Yes. Starting the wave, chanting. I don't know if she's ever been a cheerleader, but she could have a career in that. But shout out to her. She should get MVP for audience. I really enjoyed being able to go to that game or those games and watch those guys play. But also congratulations to all the other champions and winners and I think that makes 4 state championships for South Stanley this year. Is that right? Yeah. So, yeah, so that's huge. Coming from one school, so congrats there. And thank you to our public speakers. And I also had on my list, that's House Bill 993, if anybody wants to talk with Wayne about that. We really appreciate that. Going through and advocating for our students, and I totally agree that is something that just makes sense and it should happen. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Poplin. Ms. Watson.
Well, I would just like to ditto everything that everyone said. I'm really, really proud of all of our people that was awarded something tonight. Our kids are wonderful. Our school system is wonderful. And our county office is wonderful. And I hope everyone has a really, really good summer. But please read, 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 read. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Mr. Sorensen. You're always nice.
I'm going to stay on script because I don't be threatening any more the state officials with everybody. Wow, what amazing accomplishments to celebrate tonight. Too many to list, but I got to call out the two coaches and their softball teams. Dave Poplin is more than just a coach out there at South. He's an institution. And he took basically a bare bones team and took it to the max. And I can't remember where they were rated number. I think they were rated number 3 or something in the entire state across all the levels, you know, the classifications. That's pretty well. And to the West Stanley kids, I actually coached a state champion, a 2-time state champion. The only thing harder than getting a state championship is getting it twice, and they've done it 3 times. So I'm blown away by those folks. So they don't know it, but the tragedy in Uvalde and a tragic accident that took place closer to home and took one of our kids, I was physically ill. Just when the kids suffer or die, it hits me hard. The latter actually made me physically ill. I was at a tournament with my grandson he's playing baseball. And then bam, South Stanley and West Stanley are in the final rounds of the playoffs. You talk about an emotional turnaround. We had something to cheer about, something to be excited about. And I'm going to tell you the truth. When I first saw the South game at the first rounds at South, they scared me half to death. They were down 4-1, and then in the last inning, they found a way to win. But I expected both of those teams to go the distance. Because South Stanley and West Stanley kids, they are the best in the state. But anyway, nobody can say that South Stanley County Schools doesn't provide wonderful opportunities. That performance, I wish I'd have got out to see that. You know, I regret that. That was amazing. Those girls were amazing. And we got the band, national or state level band person. I mean, no one can say we're not giving these kids opportunities. I'm gonna close by jumping ship from the official capacity to a more personal one. I want to personally thank every teacher in Stanley County Schools, personally. The average layman may not know of your sacrifices, but I do. I am especially humbled by teachers that coach, advise clubs, operate academic programs, and such. You folks are my heroes. That goes for all of our amazing TAs that help them do those jobs, too. We have, I believe, the best teaching force in the state here. I want to thank every single bus driver in the county. I do know what it's like to steer a 40-foot behemoth in traffic with a load of amped-up children behind you. God bless you all. I actually had the not-so-great privilege of driving one with 28 kids behind me and a foot of snow once. Don't get into details. Those folks are miracle workers. I want to show appreciation to our cafeteria workers. I assumed the job for one day, and I ain't going back. Sorry, I ain't cut for all that real work stuff. But frankly, I couldn't do what y'all do. Those two ladies at South Middle worked harder and faster than a lot of folks working in a week, in that one day. Our amazing custodial staff, you folks rock as well. I've walked the halls and maintained a classroom. I know how exhausting that work can be. You got kids at home, you clean up after one or two kids at home. Imagine cleaning up after 500 or 400. They do a pretty amazing job. And to our central office folks, of course, can't say enough good things about our central office folks. It starts at the top and works its way down. But to all of these amazing people, you are the troops on the ground. You are the miracle workers that do so much for our kids. And often, with so little, you are Stanley County Schools, and I'm honored to know all of you.
Thank you, Mr. Sorensen. I'm not going to try to top that. Certainly, congratulations with everyone tonight. I don't know about those of you that's been on the board as long as I have, but I think this was the top board meeting for me of all times. Seriously. I have never seen as many recognitions ever. And this place was packed, and then it had to empty, and then it was packed again, then it had to empty. And then those of you that are still here, thank you. You know, we had a lot of our administrators, everyone here. We still have some here. And thank you. Thank you for all that you've done all year, and I hope that you have a wonderful summer. Our county office staff, thank you so much for what you do. And board members, I just really enjoy this board. Dr. Dennis, thank you. I hope that you're able to have a nice summer, part of it anyway. Okay, the date and location of our next board meeting will be Tuesday, August the 2nd, 2022, in the Gene McIntyre meeting room, and we are planning to start that meeting at 6:15. We do not need to go back into closed session, okay? We have finished things. So I need to turn things over, I believe, to you, Dr. Keisha Cohn.
Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. Good evening, Madam Chair and members of the board. I'd like to draw your attention to the updated personnel agenda that was in your seats. Additions that were added are in red. Section 1 requires no action, but Section 2 does require action.
Okay, board members, I believe we've had time really to look over all of this updated information that's been given to us. So I would like to have a motion to approve Section 2.
I'll make a motion to approve Section 2.
Second.
Okay, a motion by Mr. Lisk, a second by Ms. Poplin. All in favor say aye. Any opposed, no. Okay, this has carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Cohn. I need a motion to adjourn.
I make a motion, we adjourn.
Motion by Mr. Graves, a second by Ms. Poplin. All in favor say aye. Any opposed, no. We are adjourned.
Ms. Flo, will you get this document, please?